Okay, thank you very much for attending today's High Noon Club. Let's start out with our guest speaker and our friend and literally one of the very first guys that ever sat at a High Noon Club meeting, Pastor Steve Kern. He's going to talk about Christian Constitution. After he gets done with that, we're going to have a Q&A time, and thank you very much for doing this, Steve. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. It's good to have the opportunity to come and share something that's very near and dear to my heart. The fact that this nation was established as a Christian nation. That's going to be very important for us to understand. Before we get into that, I want to just give you a couple of updates. One of the things that I wanted to share with you is my campaign is going well. This is my campaign shirt that I wear going door to door. I wanted to make sure that people understood that I wasn't a tax collector or a bill collector or something. So I have my name there. And so far, since the 1st of June, since we kicked this thing off, I've knocked on 1,300 doors in District 40. And also, I've raised $15,000 and only had to spend two so far. So anyway, the campaign is moving forward. Speaking of that, the campaign, I have my push card here that I leave on the door, leave with the folks, whether they answer the door or not. You know, it's amazing to me. A lot of folks don't answer the door anymore. I've had them come and look out the window and see me standing there, and they still don't answer the door. But anyway, I don't know what that says about me. But on the front of this, you have my website and also my Facebook page that you can go and read some of the things that I'm entering there. And there's a letter in there that I wrote, and there's several other things of information for you about our campaign. So I've got some of those here if you'd like. And then, too, if you'd like to support the campaign, I've got some contribution cards here as well. Now, I put this, the Christian Constitution, together a couple of years ago after having been in a debate with a representative who is actually a Baptist preacher who represented Americans United for the Separation of Church and State. And the debate was basically, the question was, is the Constitution a Christian document or not? And of course, I was on the affirmative side, he was on the negative side, suggesting that no, the Constitution is not a Christian document. So after going through all of the resources that I read and looking into this, I decided I'd put together a PowerPoint presentation to help people understand really, who is this nation, and what is our Constitution really all about? So I want to ask you a question. How many of y'all have actually read the Constitution? Raise your hand. All right, great. Well, I have my Constitution with me here. It's actually, that's my checkbook in one pocket. here it is right here. Yeah, the Constitution. I try to read it at least a couple of times each year, and since I've been running for this Senate seat, I've read it even a couple of more times. But another thing that I'm reading now is, how many of y'all have ever read the Oklahoma Constitution? Wow. You know, I'm in the process of reading it right now. It's 180 some odd pages. This whole little booklet is just 48 pages. And pretty easy to read. The Oklahoma Constitution is 180 pages. I'm on page 67 and trying to make progress in the Constitution. But it's very interesting because there's a lot of parallels within the Oklahoma Constitution and the Christian Constitution, or our national Constitution. The preamble is a lot of it is stated pretty much basically the same. So it's important for us to know what is the law or the compact that was established by the founders of our nation, of our government, that is a contract between us and our government. And that's exactly what the Constitution is. It's a contract between the people and the government, and it's the people telling the government what the people expect of the government. That's what the Constitution is really all about. Now, why is it important for us to understand that the Constitution is a Christian document? Well, I think one of the things that happened in this session, just this last session, kind of gives us an understanding as to why we need to understand that it was a Christian document. If you'll remember, my wife, Sally Kern, state representative, she had a bill, the ALAC bill, American Laws for American Courts, that she presented and was passed in the House and the Senate and passed by the governor. But why is it important for us to have American laws for American courts? We need to understand that the United States was founded on a basic worldview. The Constitution itself is an expression of that worldview. And our founding fathers intended for our Constitution and our laws to be rooted and grounded in that worldview. When you have other people coming here from other nations that have different worldviews, such as Muslims, then you are going to have them coming here and over time wanting to try to implement within our nation things that would be contrary to our worldview and the things that we were established on. Example, Sharia law and the idea of a man being able to have four wives and as many kids as they want. Well, that's a part of Sharia law. Well, in America, it wouldn't fit here. Why? Because it is contrary to the basic worldview that our Constitution was actually established to uphold. And so one of the things that we need to understand is that when this nation was established, it was established on the basis of common law. All of our common law was rooted and grounded in one basic worldview, and that worldview is the Judeo-Christian worldview. All the common law originally in our nation, and actually even in England before they came here, was rooted and grounded in the biblical worldview, biblical understanding of those things that were right and wrong, those things rooted and grounded in a Judeo-Christian ethic. So I want us to have that understanding as we get into this explanation as to how we know that the our Constitution is a Christian Constitution based on the Judeo-Christian worldview. So let's move forward. First of all, we need to see, can you all see over here? Do I need to go over on the other side? All right. We are a Christian nation. Our president several years ago tried to say that we're not a Christian nation. We have Christians, we have Muslims, we have atheists, we have Hindus, we have Jews, we have all different kinds of people in our nation. Little does that just shows that the man doesn't understand what our history is. Our nation being a Christian nation is not determined by the makeup of our constituency, of the citizenry. Our nation and our government is based on the worldview that it was established on and that it was established as. Our nation is a Christian nation because it has been defined by its courts and by its laws to be a Christian nation because it was founded on Judeo-Christian values. And our Supreme Court agreed with that on February 29, 1892, in Church of the Holy Trinity, United States. These and many other matters which might be noticed at a volume of unofficial declarations to the mass of organic utterances that this is a Christian nation. We find everywhere a clear recognition of the same. And they had investigated this for several years before they finally came to this understanding. One of the things that supported their conclusion was the Pennsylvania Supreme Court in 1824, up to Graff versus the Commonwealth. Thus, this wise legislature, the Constitutional Convention, framed this great body of laws for a Christian country and Christian people. So, I want us to go on and see then, why is it that they understood that it was a Christian convention representative of Christian people? Now, here's our situation where we are right now. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 28 says this, "Do not move the ancient boundary which your fathers have set." What we've had seen happen in this country is that we, as Christians, have allowed our ancient boundaries to be moved. And I'm going to explain that to you when we get to the end of the presentation. But we need to make sure that we continue to claim those or reclaim those boundaries. Now, we'll go on. The Constitution is a Christian document produced by Christians to preserve a Christian social order already established in the Christian colonies for 176 years. Jamestown came in 1609. It had a charter from the king. And in that charter, it said that one of the reasons why they were establishing Jamestown was to spread the gospel on this continent with the Indians. And then when we go to 1620, when the Pilgrims came to Massachusetts and they established the Mayflower Compact, in their compact, one of the things they stated in there was that they had come to establish a Christian colony with the idea of spreading the gospel. So we see that was the establishment of a process that continued for 176 years that culminated in the putting together of the Constitution. Now, the Constitution Convention delegates. The attendees were elected by a populace that was 98% Christian in the 13 new states. And so the people in We the People were Christians with a Christian worldview. Of the 55 delegates, 52 were Christians and 3 were possible deists. In other words, they still believed in God. They weren't atheists. And they still had a Judeo-Christian worldview, actually, or biblical worldview. Of that 55 delegates, there were 28 that were Episcopalians, or you could say Anglicans, 8 Presbyterians, 2 Lutherans, and 7 Congregationalists. Now, let me say something about that, too. You've got to remember that these different churches back then were evangelical Christian organizations. They weren't liberal like many of them are today. So keep that in mind. 2 Lutherans, 7 Congregationalists, 2 Dutch Reformed, 2 Methodists, 2 Roman Catholics, and 3 possible deists. And we know that at least one of those deists was Benjamin Franklin, and Benjamin Franklin was the oldest delegate, and he also was considered to be a deist, but yet he was the one that called for prayer during the delegation, or during the time of the convention, saying we need to pray to this God that really doesn't care about what's going on here. So you have to wonder about whether these people were really deists or not. Anyway. So we see here that the whole makeup of the Constitutional Convention was rooted and grounded in the Christian worldview, Judeo-Christian biblical worldview. All right. Now, the Constitution is based on the concept of a social contract. A social contract, the concept of social contract is a evangelical Christian kind of a contract that was promoted by the reformers of the Reformation like John Calvin. John Calvin, in his Calvin Institute, said, "If they, political authorities, command anything against him, God, let it go unesteemed. And here, let us not be concerned about all the dignity which the magistrate possesses." In other words, what he's saying here, you've got a the government's got a contract with the people. If that government is, or the king is not living up to the contract, then the people are not responsible to show any respect to the leadership of that king. The French Calvinist Venancio, "There is ever and in all places a mutual and reciprocal obligation between the people and the prince. If the prince fail in his purpose, the people are exempt from obedience. The contract is made void, the rights of obligation of no force." Now, where have you read that very statement explained anywhere? The Declaration of Independence. Where did they get the concepts in the Declaration of Independence? They got it from guys like John Calvin and Samuel Rutherford and John Locke and a lot of these other guys like Samuel Rutherford here, who said, "The law is king." This we learn: the end or the purpose of having kings or any other governors is for the enjoying of justice. For there is a contract and a bargain made between the king and his people, and your oath is taken. And certainly, sir, the bond is reciprocal, goes both ways. Sir, if this bond be broken, farewell sovereignty. And that's what they were saying there on the Lexington Green when they said, "We have one king, and that king is Jesus, because this king has done away with his sovereignty because of the way that he's been abusing his power." So, the social contract is a Christian concept born in the Reformation and developed by the Puritans in England and of America. The Constitution is a social contract that begins with "we the people" and defines the limits of power granted to the new government by the people. All right, so one of the big arguments that they use, this can't be a Christian document because God is never mentioned. Well, there's reasons why God was never mentioned, and here's some of them. God is not mentioned because God was a given in the minds of the delegates. Did we not say that basically these people were all a bunch of Christians, had a Christian worldview? And secondly, religion was understood to be a state issue, not to be infringed on by the federal government. We'll be seeing that more later, because they had the understanding of states' rights in the area of freedom of religion. Number three, all 13 states were Christian with different denominations. You remember the list that we gave there? There were Episcopalians, there were Catholics, there were Methodists, there were Congregationalists. The delegates were determined to stay neutral in order not to sound prejudiced to any one denomination. Why? Because when they wanted to get this thing ratified, they had to have all of these different states with different churches in their states being willing to ratify it. So they didn't want to have that as a part of or creating controversy. Now, another thing that they try to do when they try to say that the Constitution is not a Christian document is they want to separate the Declaration of Independence from the Constitution. And they say that one is, this document's separate from the other. They don't have any connection. And why do they do that? Because you see, the Declaration of Independence actually establishes the authority for the Constitution when it mentions things like the Declaration established the nation as one founded according to the principles of freedom granted by Creator God in paragraph 2, where it says, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people. Where do the rights of the people come from? From God. The rights of the people to alter or abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such forms. Where do the principles come from? They come from their Judeo-Christian worldview, organizing powers in such form as to them shall seem to them most likely to affect their safety and their happiness. And so the Declaration of Independence established the fact that our country was rooted and grounded in understanding that our rights and that that we are a nation that's governed by Creator God. Now, the Constitution, then, we see, is a continuation of the Declaration and fully depends on the Declaration to state the national commitment to God. John Quincy Adams once stated, "The virtue which has been infused into the Constitution of the United States was no other than the concretion of those abstract principles which had been first proclaimed in the Declaration of Independence. This was the platform upon which the Constitution of the United States had been erected. Its virtues, its republican character, consisted in its conformity to the principles proclaimed in the Declaration of Independence." Who was John Quincy Adams? His father was John Adams. John Adams was one of the writers of the Declaration of Independence along with Thomas Jefferson. And of course, obviously, he explained this to his son, John Quincy Adams. Well, the United States Supreme Court said the very same thing. The U.S. Supreme Court confirmed in 1897 the connection of the two documents. The latter, the Constitution, is but the body and the letter of which the former, the Declaration of Independence, is the thought and the spirit. And it is always safe to read the letter of the Constitution in the spirit of the Declaration of Independence. What is the spirit of the Declaration of Independence? Our rights come from God, based on the Judeo-Christian worldview. Now, the Declaration is a stated purpose. The Constitution is a stated practice. The Declaration is the mission statement. The Constitution is the operation manual. The Declaration is the birth certificate. The Constitution is the birthright. So then we can go on and say, we the people that introduces the Constitution is a direct continuation of the Declaration of Independence theme in the first and second paragraphs, discussing the people's rights. Remember, the Constitution preamble begins with what? We the people. Well, what has it already been stated in the Declaration of Independence? Paragraph 1 says, when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bonds. In paragraph 2 says that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it and institute new government. Folks, we're almost there. We'll go on. The Constitution is that new government we the people instituted. All right? So, Benjamin Franklin Morris was a historian. He was also a pastor back during the pre-Civil War period of time. And he wrote The Christian Life and Character of the Civil Institutions of the United States. And he talks about the preamble here, and he says, these fundamental objects of the Constitution are in perfect harmony with the revealed objects of the Christian religion. All these words are mentioned in the preamble. Union, justice, peace, the general welfare, and the blessings of civil and religious liberty are the objects of Christianity, and always secured under its practical, beneficent reign. Well, in the Constitution, the original Constitution, you're going to find that certain words in that preamble are capitalized. They are capitalized. They are specific words deliberately capitalized in the preamble because they are seen as results from God's principles. Benjamin Franklin Morris listed them in the above quote. Union, oneness, unity. Where does that come from? It comes from God. Justice. God is a God of justice. Tranquility, peace. Jesus himself said, "Peace I give to you, not as the world gives, give I unto you." Welfare. Now, you know, Thomas Jefferson said one time, if you're going to do any kind of interpreting of the Constitution, go back to the original meaning, okay? We need to do that with this word, welfare. That wasn't entitlements that they were talking about there. They were talking about the general protection of the individuals so that they could pursue their happiness. That's all that really meant. It's really talking about police and the protection from domestic or foreign enemies. Welfare, blessings of liberty. Blessings. Where do blessings come from? They come from God. Freedom, blessings of liberty, and the liberty that comes from God. Why did they understand that we have freedom? Where does that come from, the concept of freedom? It comes from Genesis chapter 2, where God gave man choice. You can't have choice. You can't have freedom without choice. And so our founding fathers understood that the fact that God gave us choice. Now, he wanted us to live a free life, but he realized that if we were going to have a relationship with him, that was going to be a relationship that's going to be free and rooted and grounded in love and trust and those kinds of things, he had to give us choice. But also, when he gave us choice, what did he give with that choice? Responsibility and consequence. If you eat of this tree, and the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. So you're free to make choices, but you're still going to be responsible for your choices. Why? Because you were created to be free moral agents. In order to be a free moral agent, you have to be free to choose. But if you are a free moral agent, then you are also responsible for the choices that you make. Now, the problem that we got here today is we got a lot of people that want freedom, but they don't want to be responsible for their choices when the choices they make have bad consequences. We'll go on. All right. One of the major themes of the Bible is the depravity of man. When I was working on my bachelor's degree. My bachelor's degree is in psychology and sociology. And I got that degree because I didn't have to pass mathematics and statistics. But anyway, one of the things, common themes in modern psychology and sociology is the idea that man is basically good. Which is totally and completely the opposite of the Bible's understanding that man is fallen, he is depraved. And so our founding fathers had the understanding of this depravity. And they agreed with Lord Acton, who is the one who said, all power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Now, we have absolutely seen that recently, haven't we? So, anyway... Jeremiah 17:9. The heart is more deceitful than all else and is desperately sick. Who can know it? Because of man's fallen nature, the founders understood the need for checks and balances in government. And so they came up with this idea from the Bible, Isaiah 33:22. For the Lord is our judge, the Lord is our lawgiver, the Lord is our king. He will save us. And so, understanding these three different parts of government and governing, our founding fathers established the three branches of government: legislative, executive, and judicial. And so, their understanding was separate and limited powers, with each branch having oversight of the other. I always get frustrated when I come to this because I keep asking myself, where is the oversight of the Congress over this president? Where is the oversight of the Congress over the Supreme Court.
Preach it, brother.
Yeah.
They have the power, you know, to call their, to impeach these people, for crying out loud, when they violate the Constitution. But they don't realize that the Constitution they're violating is being violated because it's going against the very foundations that it was established on. A Judeo-Christian worldview. Now, so, separate and limited powers with each branch having oversight of the other. So, one of the men that they studied that gave this concept was a Frenchman named Montesquieu. He was a Catholic. He was a devout Catholic, and he was a strong, he was strongly committed to the Bible. But and let me say this. You know, when you read the Constitution Convention papers and the sources, and you read the different things that were written that was going on at the time, the minutes that were taken, those kinds of things, you'll find that the sources that are quoted, out of those sources, the Bible itself is quoted 34% of the time. Montesquieu was second. Montesquieu was quoted 9% of the time. And then Blackstone, William Blackstone from England, who had the laws on commentary that's rooted and grounded in the Bible, biblical worldview, was quoted something like 5%, and I think John Locke was 2%, something like that. Anyway, but you have to understand something. When they were quoting those men were quoting the Bible. For the and getting the principles and the understanding of those principles from the Bible. That was their authority. And so Montesquieu, with Isaiah 33 in mind, said, "Nor is there liberty of the power of judging is not separated from legislative power and from executive power. If it, the power of judging, were joined to legislative power, the power over life and liberty of the citizens would be arbitrary, for the judge would be the legislator." Wait a minute, I think we're beginning to see that today. Yes. Legislating from the bench. "If it were joined to the executive power, the judge could have the force of an oppressor." Well, you don't have, you got a president, but if he can get his people in the courts to do what he wants to do, then all of a sudden, what have you ended up with? You're still ending up with oppression. Let's see. "All would be lost if the same body of principled men exercised these three powers." Even though they were principled, having those three powers together. What did we say about power? Absolute power corrupts absolutely. So we see this principle. Now, another thing that we see that's a principle from the Bible, elected representative by the people in Scripture, Acts 6. "But select from among you, brethren, seven men of good reputation, full of spirit and of wisdom, whom we may put in charge of this tax, of this task." 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 4. "Then the men of Judah came, and they anointed David king over the house of Judah." And so he became king. Wait a minute. Think about that. David was anointed by Samuel to be king long before Saul was removed. But we see here that David was not affirmed as king of the people until the people themselves finally chose him to be king. So they were then in agreement with God on the basis of God's choice, but it still required the people's vote. Why? Because he was going to be representing the people as their king. Now, I must have done something here. I'm going the wrong way. All right. 2 Samuel 13, 17 through 18. "Now Abner and a constitution with the elders of Israel, saying," remember who Abner was? Abner was Saul's general. And so Abner became convinced that to join the nation together and unify the nation, David needed to be king. So he said this, "In times past, you were seeking for David to be king over you. Now then, do it." So he's telling those that were the followers of Saul to go ahead and what? Elect David as their king. So we see that even though David was God's choice, the people still had a say in David becoming king. Legislators elected by the people, Article 1, Section 2, the House of Representatives shall be composed of members chosen every second year by the people of the several states. Section 3, senators were originally chosen by the legislature of each state, but Amendment 17 says the Senate of the United States shall be composed of two senators from each state, elected by the people thereof for 6 years. The president is to be elected by the people as well. Article 2, Section 1, the executive power shall be used in a president of the United States of America, vested. He shall hold his office during the term of 4 years, and together with the vice president chosen for the same term, be elected as follows, and goes on and shows the electoral process. Now, another thing it says about this, that the president was to be a natural born citizen. Deuteronomy 17:15. One from among your countrymen you shall set as king over yourselves. What is that saying? That is saying there that you have to have a king over the people who has the same worldview that people have. They need to be, if he's going to be able to rule them according to the way that they deserve to be ruled, then he needs to be one of them who's come from them and has the same world view. Now, we go on and we see that he also must be 35 years of age. 1 Timothy 3:6, not a novice. Well, to me, 35 years of age, I turned 67 yesterday, that's young. You know what I mean? Of course, back then, I mean, what was the medium lifespan? About 40, 45, something like that. So, anyway. Here's another thing that example of how we know that this is rooted and grounded in a Christian worldview. Sunday's exempted. Article 1, Section 7, if any bill shall not be returned by the president within 10 days, Sunday's exempted. That's included in the Constitution. Friday is a Muslim holy day of worship. Saturday is a Jewish holy day of worship. And Sunday is the Christian holy day of worship. And those that were putting together the Constitution were all what? Christians. And so they all believed that you were supposed to rest on the Sabbath day, and so they included that in their Constitution. Now this is very important. Oaths are affirmation, rewards of punishments in a final judgment. One of the things that's required is oaths. Or affirmation. Why is that important? Well, it's important because you want to have people that you're electing who are not only going to be responsible to you, but they're going to be responsible to God for the decisions that they make on your behalf. And so you want people who are going to be making decisions based on the fact that they're going to have to give an account for that. So they're going to think twice before they do something that goes against God's laws. So, it says here, in order to give an oath, what do you have to believe in? You got to believe in God. Well, Article 6, the senators and representatives before mentioned and the members of the several state legislators and all executive and judicial officers, both the United States and of the several states, shall be bound by oath or affirmation to support this Constitution. Daniel Webster then said, "What is an oath? It is founded on a degree of consciousness that there is a power above us that will reward our virtues or punish our vices." So it's good to have people elected to office that have this understanding. It's kind of like an atheist coming to the door. You're knocking on the door and you say, well, you know, I'm Steve Kern, I'm running for office. And he says, I can't vote for you. And why not? Well, I'm an atheist and you believe in God. And so what I would ask him is basically this. Okay, do you want someone representing you who basically doesn't believe in God and doesn't, because he doesn't believe in God, doesn't believe that he's going to have to give an answer to anybody about his, about the things that he did? Is that somebody you want to put in office, or do you want to put somebody in office that even if you don't believe in God yourself, if he believes in God, you know that he's going to tell you the truth because he believes he's got to give an answer to God for that. So who are you going to trust? That's a good question. So, affirmation is a total Christian concept. Oath and affirmation. This affirmation thing is not about somebody that doesn't believe in God. Oh, I'm going to affirm that I'll, on the basis of my own, on my own honesty. No, that's not what this is about. The affirmation is a total Christian concept. Matthew 5:34. But I say to you, make no oath at all. Matthew 5:37. But let your statement be yes, yes, or no, no. To some Christians, giving an oath violated their conscience. So they were allowed to give a statement of affirmation of responsibility to God and the people they were to serve to up to hold the Constitution. Well, it says to me that somebody that wants to give an affirmation rather than an oath really is someone that seems to have a stronger conscience about their relationship to God, even than the person that does the oath. And so we see this concept of affirmation is totally and completely New Testament. Trial by jury. Article 3, Section 2, the trial of all crimes except in cases of impeachment shall be by jury, and such trial shall be held in state where the state crime shall be committed. And if they are found not guilty, then they should be released and seen as not guilty and not continuing to try to get this guy on the basis of, you know, some other kind of a thing because you believe that he's a racist or something. Deuteronomy 17:6-7. On the evidence of two witnesses or three witnesses, he who is to die shall be put to death. He shall not be put to death on the evidence of one witness. The hand of the witnesses shall be first against him to put him to death, and afterward the hand of all the people. Corruption of blood. Have you ever heard that before? Comes from the Bible, Articles 3, Section 2. The Congress shall have power to declare the punishment of treason, but no attainder of treason shall work corruption of blood. What does that mean? Deuteronomy 24:16. Fathers shall not be put to death for their sons, nor shall sons be put to death for their fathers. Everyone shall be put to death for his own sins. Listen, when you stand before Jesus, when the final judgment comes, it's just going to be you and him. And you're going to just have to give an account for your life. You're not going to be able to use your parents as an excuse or somebody else there. You're going to be responsible for the choices that you made. That's what this is really all about. A republic government. America, the republic. Article 4, Section 4. The United States shall be guarantee to every state in this union a republican form of government. Why a republican form of government? What was the understanding of our founding fathers? James Madison, who's considered to be the father of the Constitution. We may define a republic to be a government which derives all its powers directly or indirectly from the great body of people and is administered by persons holding their offices during pleasure for a limited period. Okay, now during pleasure. I mean, what's that talking about? going out and have dinner? No. During the pleasure of what or who? The people. If the people don't have pleasure, you being in office, they have the right to remove you. Noah Webster said this, our citizens should early understand that the genuine source of correct republican principles is the Bible, particularly the New Testament or the Christian religion. David Barton, who will be speaking tonight, and I'll have the opportunity to introduce him. David Barton in the American Republic, The principles which did not change and which were certain and universal in their operation upon all the members of the community were principles of biblical natural laws. He's quoting there Benjamin Rush, one of our founding fathers. Another principle we find in the Constitution, it's a biblical principle, Article 6, all debts contracted and engagements entered into before the adoption of this Constitution shall be as valid against the United States under this Constitution as under the Confederation. Romans 13:8, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another, for he who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the law. And so they were under the Articles of Confederation, but now they're establishing a new government. Well, what are they saying? Well, we still are going to pay the French for the Revolutionary War what we owe them. We're going to pay all these other debts that we owe to those who we've had to borrow from in order to do our governance. No, and no religious test. Now, this is something that those who try to say it's not a Christian constitution, they say this is, look here, it says here that there shall be no religious test by the Constitution, suggesting then that anybody can serve and they don't have to be a Christian or not, they can be anything they want to be and still hold office. Well, Article 6. But no religious test shall ever be required as a qualification to any office or public trust under the United States. James Madison said this, the civil rights of none shall be abridged on the account of belief or worship, nor shall any national religion be established. Did you see that underlined? National religion. Okay? In other words, there's not going to be a religious test that you have to belong to the national church in order to be able to serve in the national government. All right, now, Joseph Story wrote this, the whole power over the subject of religion, and Joseph Story was a member of the Supreme Court, the whole power over the subject of religion is left exclusively to the state governments to be acted upon according to their own sense of justice and state constitutions. And so what are they saying here? The reason why there is no religious test to be elected to the national offices was because they had to pass the religious tests in the states. And they understood that the states were not going to pass people. Have you read any of the constitutions of the states at that time? In order to hold any office in the states at that time, you had to be a member of a church. So, they just left it to the states. So, finally, the year of our Lord, of the states, Article 7, of the states present, the seventh day of September, in the year of our Lord, 1787. The year of our Lord is a recognition of the Christian calendar done in convention by the unanimous consent, but also states an understanding of the sovereignty of Christ over their deliberations in his process of time. In other words, they're saying, in the year of our Lord, this is our Lord year, and we lived in this year, and basically he has been Lord over the whole thing. They're acknowledging his lordship there. All right, now. So, the Bill of Rights then, the first 10 amendments added to the Constitution to further define the limits of power granted the federal government. Limited government is a Christian concept based on individual freedom. Our freedom is a gift of God. Every new law passed lessens our freedom and increases government's power, which leads to slavery. Have you ever seen the picture in London where you have some Muslims that are protesting? One of the signs they have there, what does it say? To hell with freedom. Yeah. To hell with freedom. Why? Because they have a worldview that doesn't understand the freedom of choice. You know, if you choose not to be a Muslim, what happens? They cut your head off. If you're a Christian, if you're not a Christian, but a Christian tries to lead you to Jesus, does he cut your head off if you say no? Why? Because we respect your right to choose, your freedom to choose. Well, Samuel Adams, the right to freedom being the gift of God Almighty, is not in the power of man to alienate this gift and voluntarily become a slave. What is Samuel Adams saying there? God has given us freedom as a gift. We are responsible to protect it and not give it up. To do so is to disobey God and have a sense of thanksgiving for the freedom that we have. We have a responsibility to protect our freedom given to us by God as a free gift. Now, why we are where we are now, the dialectic process is why. That's been going on ever since the establishment of our Constitution. And you know the process, you've heard it, thesis, antithesis, antithesis, and synthesis. What is it? Well, we had a thesis. Our Constitution and the establishment of our government as a Christian, Judeo-Christian based government, national government based on Judeo-Christian ethic and values, all right, which included a Christian worldview, absolutes with absolute truths. I read the other day where a lady called in to Glenn Beck the other day and said, "Oh, there are no absolutes." Well, just ask the question, well, do you believe that to be an absolute? A Christian worldview, there are absolutes. There are ethics. What are ethics? Ethics are boundaries that are set by what? The absolutes. Where do the absolutes come from? They come from a sovereign God. Do you know that some of our schools in the East now don't teach ethics? Why? Because they believe in relativism. And if you believe in relativism, then where does the power for authority for ethics come from? It comes from your ethic becomes whoever who has the power and who's in control at the time. But when our Constitution was established, the Judeo-Christian worldview was our ethic. Personal responsibility, private property, free markets, people power, the powers in the people, all these things coming from our worldview. All right, but you had these folks and who have this concept of antithesis, who didn't like this kind of stuff, and who created the concepts of modernism and secular humanism. There were those who were already pushing the idea of doing away with absolutes and all this kind of thing. And then Darwin came along with his evolution, and they embraced that, people like Marx and Hegel and all these kinds of guys. And so then the concept of relativism began to take root. Why? Because if evolution is true and everything is just evolving, then that would hold true in their understanding that basically, why do you need God? And so then if there is no God, there's no absolutes. If there's no absolutes, then everything basically becomes relative. And to the point now to where we are with postmodernism, where they're now saying, well, there may be truth, but nobody can know it. Well, relativism, situational ethics, generalized power. So then, what's happened? Well, the synthesis. Tolerance has become the norm. Libertarianism and social justice. As where we have come to, okay, well, tolerance. What do we mean by tolerance? Well, it used to be our founding fathers were tolerant. They said, okay, we're going to let Jews come to the United States. We're going to let Hindus come. We're going to let Muslims and all those come. Why? Because we know that we have the truth. And we'll tolerate them and we'll let them have their beliefs. But what we're going to do is we're going to try to win them to Jesus. But we'll tolerate them, and we understand that they're made in the image of God, and so they have freedom to choose or not to choose themselves. So we'll tolerate them. Well, all of a sudden, though, this whole idea of pluralism and how that we have to, all the different gods, you know, of ways to God are the same God and all this kind of stuff. That's been the result of this antithesis kind of thinking going on. Now tolerance is about, okay, I tolerate all religions. In other words, I respect their religion just as much as I respect mine, and they are just as much involved with God as I am. It's the same God. You know, well, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. What do we know about truth? Truth doesn't contradict itself. If you have Jesus saying certain things and you have other religions out there that are saying the opposite of it, then one can be true, the other's true, but they both can't be true. And so, but where are we today? Because of all this mess here, now we've got this tolerance here that anyone that believes that truth is absolute and that absolute is rooted and grounded in God, what are we now? Bigoted, closed-minded, divisive, judgmental, hateful. And then this concept of libertarianism. If everything is just relative and everybody is free and should be free to do whatever they want to do, whenever they want to do it, where they are, wherever they want to do it, and what difference does it make what somebody does in their own bedroom? How does that hurt anybody else? All this kind of thinking. They ought to be free to do that, so let's let them smoke pot if they want. So we'll pass laws to let them smoke pot, even if it could be detrimental to the social order of things. If they want to get married, well, who are we to say that that's right or wrong? And so we don't really have any kind of absolute to tell us that it is or isn't. So, all right, let them do what they want to do. And then social justice. Basically, then, is that the government then is whoever's in power, and then the government uses social justice to keep people under their control in order to maintain their power. So that's the process that we've been in. But what's the answer? We don't need any more change. What we need is a fix-it, and the fix-it is this. We need restoration. And what is the restoration that we need? We need to be restored back to our founding Judeo-Christian worldview. But what's the problem? We have a whole generation of kids, two or three generations now, that have been growing up in public schools that won't even allow them to talk about God. Which is the foundation of our whole constitutional authority. And so, we need to claim our right to the original thesis established by the founders, the Judeo-Christian worldview. And the only way we're going to start doing that now, people, is through private schools, through through homeschooling, and through teachers who go into the public schools and are willing to teach this kind of stuff, and parents going to boards, their school boards, and saying, we want this in our school, and start saying, get the federal government out of our schools. Let us have local control, and we will teach in our schools what we want to have taught in our schools, because we're the ones that pay the taxes. So, we need to claim our right to the original thesis established by the founders, the Judeo-Christian world view. Thank you very much.
Somebody get the light there, sir. Just an outstanding job. Thank you very much for doing that.
I gonna have any questions?
Yeah, we're gonna have a little Q&A. So anybody's got a question or whatever, raise your hand. Just a point that from your lecture I'd like for you to comment on. When the Declaration says that they were dissolving the political bonds, we know that they labored over every word in that Declaration. They spent hours and hours fussing about this word, that comma, that period, all of that. They could just as easily have said, we are dissolving the political and religious bonds. But they didn't. The Church of England was the established church of England. I mean, Anglican Church was the Church of England, okay? So in a very much realistic sense, even though it was corrupt, England too was a Christian nation. And all of these founders were British citizens before they declared their independence. So it would be kind of crazy to all of a sudden say, well, they've cast off their religious affiliation. They didn't. They could have easily have said, we'll dissolve both the political and the religious bonds, but they didn't, just the political bonds. So absolutely they were Christian. Francis Schaeffer actually uses the word, the one that I prefer. He says that the Constitution was founded on Christian consensus, that is an indisputable fact. You can maybe argue with the worldviews of these other things, but you cannot argue with demographics that the United States was founded on a Christian consensus. That's the word that Francis Schaeffer uses, a theologian.
Let me say something about that too, Paul. I'm not asking for anything that isn't already happening everywhere in the world. If you go to Saudi Arabia, what do you have to do? You have to live under Sharia law, whether you agree with the Quran or not. You go anywhere in the world, you go to Russia, or anything, you live under their constitutions and stuff, which are not rooted and grounded in a biblical worldview. But yet, that's their country. And that's the authority that they've established there. We have every right in this country to say our laws are going to be rooted and grounded in a Judeo-Christian worldview because that's what our Constitution was established on.
That's right.
And so that's why we can say that same-sex marriage is unconstitutional.
Right.
Why? Because it goes against the very worldview that we established our Constitution on in the first place.
Next question.
Steve, thank you very much for your presentation. I, as a lawyer, and I know some of our speakers have mentioned the Supreme Court case of Holy Trinity Church versus U.S., an 1892 case. The Supreme Court held these and many other matters, which might be noticed, add a volume of unofficial declarations to the mass of organic utterances that this is a Christian nation.
That's right.
What do you think the Supreme Court would rule today if they had the same case before them?
Interesting.
Yeah, well, the problem with that is, okay, is you had a Supreme Court at that time that was still made up of people who basically had a Judeo-Christian worldview and who were not products of revisionist history. But that's what we have today, though, is you have people that are products of revisionist history, those who bought into the antithesis arguments, who now are taking over the control of things. And that's what we have in the White House right now. We have a president that basically is a postmodernist. He is committed to the antithesis kind of understanding of reality. And so, obviously, I believe that it probably would go like everything else does, 5-4, probably against the idea of us being a Christian nation, just on the basis of the difference between the worldview understanding of the Constitution.
Question.
Hey, I'm Travis. Thank you, Steve, for an excellent presentation. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
I see it's being videoed. Are we going to have an opportunity to have access to a copy
of
the video of this?
That's why we're videoing it.
Well, good. I appreciate that.
Okay.
You know, I might add, that is still one of the issues. That is one of the ideas of the web page also. Anytime we have guest speakers like that, we'll record things or whatever, we'll be able to drive people to that website, and you'll be able to see the presentation. So hopefully, after we get all done here today, we'll get that and put that thing on there. Yeah. Now, there's one additional thing that I might add also regarding our webmaster. He's a little bit inexperienced, but he tries his very best.
Who is that?
We don't want to mention his name.
I'm Woody. Thank you, Steve. This is a great presentation. I'm going to call the Judeo-Christian worldview the biblical worldview. Now, since God created man, and he is, I'm trying to get this right, and he's revealed everything that's in the Bible to us, would it not be safe to say that our system of government works best because it is a Christian worldview, a biblical worldview, and we were made by our Creator for that to be the plan for us how to live? The Bible is the blueprint, let's call it, and we the people are the product of that blueprint. Yeah. We were made to work that way.
Right.
It works best that way.
Yeah. To me, the greatest argument against homosexuality is in Genesis 1:1, you have God creating or establishing a standard. Okay? And what is that standard? He creates a man and he creates a woman. Okay? And then he declares that actually it's the man and the woman that is the direct expression of the image of God. Them together in relationship. That is the standard that is established. Then when you have in the rest of the Bible, when it talks about other things that go against the standard, basically are called abominations. Why? Because they are blasphemous in their relationship to expressing the true image of God. You see. And so you have the argument there in Genesis 1:26 that basically God made man in his image, a man and a woman. And so that's the standard. And that's the reason why we in America have always held to monogamous marriage, because that's a part of our worldview.
Well, so question.
My name's Lewis.
Yes,
we all know that when our founders signed the Declaration of Independence, mm-hmm. they created treason. So what's going to keep us from creating treason if we want to try to change the way that things are now? There is going to be no way that I can see, because of the ruling class that is in Washington, D.C. right now.
It might be treason in the mind of those who have the power. Okay? But it's not treason in the fact that the power belongs to the people. And so when the people determine that it's time to change the government, because the government has basically nullified their contract with the people, then the people have the right to remove the government, and that's not treason. That's establishing the responsibility that we have to protect our freedoms.
You know, I think that also that debate literally came effect during and really literally after the Civil War, because the South, there was that big check and balance, and Abraham Lincoln was so afraid of that one issue that was he going to brand the Southerners as the Confederates as treasonous to the Constitution. So again, that's literally been quite, and he was very afraid of that. We know that. And so anyway, next question.
I'm Don.
Hey, Don.
It's a great presentation, Steve.
Thank you.
Just wanted to mention that Congress itself commissioned a study, I think it was in maybe 1890 or so, about whether this was a Christian nation or not. And I think that study's mentioned in the book, The 5,000 Year Leap, if you have a copy of that. But the remarks from that study would be useful as an insert into your presentation.
Yeah.
I would also like to comment on the gentleman's remark back there about treason. Thomas Jefferson himself said that defense of the Constitution is not rebellion or insurrection. So if whatever you're doing is in defense of the Constitution, you have a valid right to do it.
The problem that we get into today is you have the two concepts, and you know this, the those of us that are committed to original intent. And then you have the others that are in our courts and things, so many claiming it to be, because of the concept of evolution, they are claiming it to be a living document. And so you get into all of these kinds of things when you can say original intent, this is exactly what they mean, and you can prove it by going through and reading what they said, because they told us exactly what they meant. But now you have the other side that basically says, well, it doesn't matter what it meant then, because now it's a living document and it's evolved to the point now that we're interpreting on the basis of the way that things are now rather than on the original intent. That all got started back in Harvard University with Langdell and then Holmes and the others that started implementing this concept of you don't rule on in court on the basis of the Constitution. You rule on the basis of precedent that's been set, and they always use the precedent that's basically been set at that basic time, not going back in history, because of this concept of living document.
Living, breathing document, what yeah, they do. Okay, next question.
Well, I'm Sally, and I don't really have a question, but in reference to what Woody was saying, John Adams said our Constitution was made only for moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the governance of any other. So yes, our Constitution was designed. It's not an inspired document like the Bible is, but I believe God was a part of fashioning this document. It's the longest surviving Constitution in the world, and that's because it's founded upon truisms and everlasting principles.
Absolutes.
Amen. Hey, Steve Kern, thank you very much for doing
this. Let me say one thing real quick. Listen, when you're considering voting or supporting candidates, whether you live in their district or not, what you want to do is you want to support candidates that have the same worldview that you have. Whether you are, because even though they may not be in your district, when they go to the Capitol to represent their district, actually they're going to be representing you, because every decision they make will have an effect on you. And you want people in there that you know have the right worldview. And so I'm saying that to say, I may not be, or you may not be in my district, but that doesn't mean I don't need your help.
Okay. Well, time's up. One additional thing I want you to think about today, after today's discussion on the Constitution, the biblical Constitution, is literally out of Vermont last year or the year before, I can't remember which year it was, but I think it was the last legislative year, not this one, but the one in 12 in the state of Vermont. They came up with a concept of an idea, and I'm going to talk to our legislators a little bit, because I want our people to also understand this thought process. They came up with the idea, and literally it was a liberal idea, but it is an idea of a constitutional item, that they wanted their state constitution and they wanted the federal constitution to identify these one select group of people. When we were looking at these different articles 1 and section 2 or whatever, it's always about we the people, or the people, right? People. Not the corporation, not the super PACs, not the little PACs, the people. And what they did, they came up with the idea, which we had in Oklahoma too, the same idea, and it failed miserably at the House of Representatives. Miserably, okay, with the leadership, miserably, the idea of a personhood bill. A right of a citizen, the inborn citizen, okay, felt miserably. So when our leadership talks about wanting to believe in the Constitution of the United States, Constitution of Oklahoma, they're deceiving the people, okay, and it's always the people. So anyway, here was a concept of idea, that no money could come from anybody except the person. The personhood of the state, or of Vermont. So again, what I would like to do, I would like to get one of our legislators this year to start working with that idea with the Oklahoma Constitution, give the identity to have a person. You've got to be a person to be able to donate money to campaigns. You've got to be a person, not a super PAC, not a corporation. Okay? okay? Not a state chamber of commerce funding candidates, okay? Let's get some teeth to that idea, that idea, okay? Let's think about that. We're going to have some more discussion about that later on. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Again, thank you, Steve Kern. Great presentation. Next week, Eunice Corey is going to talk about Obamacare at High Noon Club. Thanks, everybody.
We don't agree, Bob.
You don't. You do.
Listen, because you grew a big leg.